Intracranial tumors. The term intracranial tumor include metastasis, which is the commonest intracranial and the commonest brain tumor. Metastasis is the commonest. And also include primary tumors arises from the skull, meninges, brain tissues. Any tumor arises from the cranial nerve or pituitary gland, pineal gland. Any tumor arises from blood vessels, or any tumor arises from congenital remnants. What is the pathology of intracranial tumors? Intracranial tumor can be classified into the commonest, first of all, metastasis. Metastasis is the commonest intracranial tumor and the commonest brain tumor. Usually the metastasis arises from primary in lung or breast. Less commonly, tumor arises from the prostate or kidney. And we all know that these tumors, lung, breast, prostate, and the kidneys, are malignant tumors famous with blood spread. And the malignant cells runs in the bloodstream going to brain or other sites like liver or bone, etc. Primary tumors. The primary tumors, first of all, glial tumors. Glial tumor arise from the glial tissues, which are the connective tissue of the CNS. These tumors are called glial tumors or gliomas. The gliomas include, first of all, astrocytoma. Stop at this type. Astrocytoma is the commonest primary malignant brain tumor in adult. Take care in MCQ. Astrocytoma is the commonest primary malignant tumor in adults. Also, gliomas include oligodendroglioma, ependymoma, and glioblastoma. All these are glial tumor or gliomas. There are tumors arise from the meninges called meningioma. The meningioma actually arises from the arachnoid tissue, and usually meningioma is benign. Also, there is acoustic neuroma, which arises from the acoustic nerve, which is the eighth cranial nerve. Pituitary tumors or tumors arise from embryological remnants, like medulloblastoma. Stop here. Medulloblastoma is the commonest primary malignant tumor in the brain and arises from the brain tissue in children. Astrocytoma is the commonest brain tumor in adults, while in children, medulloblastoma, which usually appear in the first decades. Rarely, congenital tumor, like craniopharyngioma or dermoids. Finally, and rarely, there is vascular tumors. Vascular tumors like hemangioma or hemangioblastoma. This is the classification of intracranial tumors, metastases, and other primary tumors. Additional notes for MCQ. We know the commonest tumor in the brain, which is metastases. The commonest primary in adult, astrocytoma. The commonest primary malignant tumor in the brain in children, medulloblastoma. We should add, what is the commonest tumor in the spinal cord? Spinal cord, from the spinal cord, the commonest tumor, about 50 or 60%, is called ependymoma, which is a tumor arising from the ependymal cells, which line the passage of CSF. In addition to the commonest spinal cord tumor, which is ependymoma, what is the commonest tumor arising from the peripheral nerve? The commonest tumor arising from the peripheral nerve is schwannoma, or also called neurilimoma. Neurilimoma. These tumors in the peripheral nerve arise from the Schwann cells, which form the myelin sheath. We return to the intracranial tumor and the brain tumor. What is the clinical picture? What is the clinical picture of intracranial tumor? First of all, and usually the earliest, is impairment of cerebral function, like amnesia, irritability, confusion, followed by, when the tumor enlarge enough, it will produce manifestation of increased intracranial tension. The first manifestation of increased intracranial tension is headache. Headache is present in about one third of cases of intracranial tumor, and the character of headache, the nature, the site of the headache depends on the site of the tumor, variable according to the site of the tumor. And the headache here is due to increased intracranial tension or due to stretch of the meninges. In addition to headache, vomiting. What is the differential diagnosis of vomiting due to any cause like GIT diseases, cholecystitis, appendicitis, etc., and the vomiting due to increased intracranial tension? We said in head injury before that vomiting in increased intracranial tension is not preceded by nausea. Vomiting is projectile in case of increased intracranial tension, not related to meals, and usually occurs in early morning. Beside headache and vomiting, as a manifestation of increased intracranial tension, there is blurring of vision. Blurring of vision early due to papilledema. Papilledema. And late due to optic nerve atrophy. We should notice that for MCQ, papilledema is the most important and the most significant sign of increased intracranial tension. Sign, the most significant sign in increased intracranial tension is papilledema. In addition to papilledema, there is focal manifestation. And this focal manifestation depends upon the site of the tumor. For example, tumor affecting the motor area of the brain will produce hemiplegia, or tumor affecting the Broca's area of speech will produce aphasia. In addition to focal manifestation and increased intracranial tension, there is maybe epileptic fits. Why epileptic fits? Due to irritation of the neurons around the tumor. What are the investigations of increased intracranial tension? And the investigations for intracranial tumor. Sure, in any intracranial disease, the main investigation is CT and MRI. But we can do Billing X-ray. Billing X-ray show manifestation, first of all, manifestation of increased intracranial tension. According to the age of the patient, if there is increased intracranial tension in infancy and early childhood, before closure of the suture line, the increased intracranial tension will produce this. What is this? Marked separation of suture lines. If increased intracranial tension occur before closure of suture line. But if increased intracranial tension occur after closure of suture lines, the increased intracranial tension will compress the inner table of the skull. Compression of inner table of the skull with erosion and decalcification of the inner table of the skull will produce these black areas. These black areas, like silver beaten appearance or like finger prints. You grasp the white skull by your dirty hand will give these finger prints or silver beaten appearance if increased intracranial tension occur after closure of suture line. Increased intracranial tension will affect also the midline structures, leading to shift of midline structures, which appear well in CT scan and MRI. Midline structure like this. What is this? This calcified body in the midline is called bienial body. Appear white and should be in the midline. In case of tumor in one side, the tumor in one side will shift the bienial body to the opposite side. Also shift of midline structures here. Large tumor on the right side will shift all the midline structures to the opposite side. In Billing X-ray, the clinoid process will appear. What is the clinoid process? This. In lateral view, Billing X-ray of skull, appear the cella turcica, the site of the pituitary gland in the cella turcica. And cella turcica is limited anteriorly by anterior clinoid process and posteriorly by the posterior clinoid process. And normally the size of the cella turcica is about the size of your, the tip of your little finger. This is a normal cella turcica and the anterior and the posterior clinoid process. In case of pituitary tumor, the pituitary gland enlarged, leading to ballooning of cella turcica. This is in Billing X-ray, and this is in MRI, ballooning of cella turcica. And just below the cella turcica, there is the sphenoid air sinus. This is the sphenoid air sinus below the cella turcica. Here, pituitary tumor leading to ballooning of cellula tersica and becomes larger in size than the tip of your little finger. If there is a supracellular tumor above the cellula tersica, if there is supracellular tumor, the anterior and the posterior colon process becomes eroded, leading to suscarization of cella tersica. Beside these features in Berlin X-ray and CT scan and the MRI, we can also perform CT angiography. CT angiography to show the vascularity of the tumor and the feeding blood vessels. Finally, what is the treatment of intracranial tumors? First of all, surgical treatment is the main line of treatment. Before we perform surgery, if the patient has a sign of brain compression, and you should notice that brain compression is the commonest cause for death in neurosurgical patient. Therefore, if there is increased intracranial tension with brain compression, urgent decompression by intravenous dehydration. Intravenous 25% dextrose or mannitol. And we give dexamethasone as a corticosteroid to decrease the edema around the brain. If there is associated hydrocephalus, as we all know from pediatric, if there is hydrocephalus should be decompressed by ventriculoperitoneal shunt. The routine classical method for excision of brain tumor is open surgery. Open surgery by bone skull flap. If there is a brain tumor in the anterior cranial fossa, we perform frontal osteoblastic flap. But if the tumor in the middle cranial fossa, we perform temporal osteoblastic flap. If there is brain tumor in the posterior cranial fossa, we perform suboccipital craniotomy. Suboccipital craniotomy for tumor in the posterior cranial fossa, which may be occipital loop tumor or cerebellar tumor. This is the open surgery. But nowadays and recently, there are recent neurosurgical techniques for excision and removal of intracranial tumor. Like what? Like this. What is this? By CT or MRI guided stereotactic surgery. What is CT or MRI guided stereotactic surgery? This technique nowadays is performed for biopsy or excision of deeply seated brain tumors. What is the method? We put around the head. We put around the head a frame to fix the head completely. And by CT or MRI, we accurately perform three-dimensional pictures by CT scan or MRI to localize the tumor very accurately. And after accurate three-dimensional localization of the tumor through a very small hole in the skull, bare hole or trephine hole, we introduce very small fine instruments to take a biopsy or to excise the deeply seated tumor. Therefore, this depends upon three-dimensional localization of the tumor by CT or MRI. Also surgically, there is a microsurgical excision of the tumor. Microsurgical using optical magnification. Or if the tumor lies inside the ventricles of the brain, we can enter the ventricle by neuroscopy. Neuroscopic excision of the tumor if the tumor is localized inside the ventricles. This is the recent surgical techniques. Nowadays, there are other techniques replacing and alternative to surgery. Like what? Like this, MRI or CT. But now MRI is used and more accurate. MRI guided and three-dimensional, like we mentioned before, we localize the tumor. Then alternative to surgery is laser ablation of the tumor. This is preferable to surgery in deep, inaccessible, dangerous brain tumor. Or very, very, very important line of treatment. In treatment of intracranial and brain tumor is radiotherapy. And radiotherapy, we mentioned in breast cancer and many malignancies. Now radiotherapy is very accurate, localized on the tumor by MRI guided radiotherapy. And the same here, by accurate three-dimensional localization by MRI, we localize the tumor, and radiotherapy will be very accurate and very localized to the tumor. In addition, chemotherapy in certain cases, in case of malignant intracranial tumor, can be done. And finally, and the most recent line of treatment, in treatment of primary malignant brain tumor or intracranial tumor is tumor treating field. What is tumor treating field? This tumor treating field is a wearable device on the scalp, and this device create mild electric fields. These mild electric fields from the scalp penetrate the skull, penetrate to the tumor tissue, leading to interruption of cellular division of this tumor. This slow and delay spread of the tumor. This is the most recent line of treatment in intracranial and brain tumors, which is treatment by electric fields. This is called tumor treating fields. And these fields are electric fields. Delay spread of malignant cells, therefore delay growth and delay spread of this tumor. Finally, what is the treatment of brain metastases? Treatment of brain metastases is mainly radiotherapy only. except in one case. If the brain metastasis is single and the primary tumor has a limited dissemination. Single brain tumor and the primary with limited dissemination, we suspect that the life of this patient is more than 2 months. And we can elongate the life of the patient by surgical excision of the primary, followed by radiotherapy on the site of the single metastasis. Therefore, all cases radiotherapy only, except one case, single brain metastasis, primary with limited dissemination, and you suspect life of the patient more than 2 months, then take the risk of surgical excision followed by radiotherapy, which is the main line of treatment of brain metastasis. Thank you for good listening and good luck.